Let me show you how I set up the animator controller for this character here. Okay, to begin with, in our base layer, we have two substate machines, movement and combat. Let's just ignore this bit here. We will come back to this later. If we go to movement, I have made a simple setup. There is another substate machine to pick a random idle animation, and then two other normal states, walk and run. Because substate machines have a default transition, this orange one here, we cannot directly transition from empty to all of these states, because the default transition will have priority over all other transitions. Therefore, we need to use an in-between empty state to make things work. I have made an empty state and called it empty, just to be clear. And on entry to movement, we transition to this state. An important thing to note here that whenever we use empty states, we need to uncheck write defaults in the properties. When this is enabled, the animator writes default values to all properties that are not explicitly animated by the current state, and that may lead to some visual glitches. So I best recommend whenever you use empty states, leave this unchecked. Okay? Now from empty, we go to idle when a float parameter speed is less than 0.1. Just note that when we connect this transition on this pop-up menu, we need to choose the substate machine itself and not any particular state or state machine inside of that. So we choose state machine, and then we choose the name of this state machine, which is idle, okay? So we go to idle when speed is less than 0.1. We go to walk when speed is greater than 0.1 and less than 0.6. And we go to run when speed is greater than 0.6. I don't know why, but Unity hasn't added a greater than or equals or less than or equals condition. But we need to make sure that the speed either constantly updates itself or it doesn't equals 0.1 or 0.6 in this case. So we just need to make sure that speed doesn't equals this value. Otherwise, it will loop over empty itself. Now from walk, we go to idle when speed gets low and goes to run when speed gets higher than 0.6. The same logic applies from run as well. Okay? And so far, nothing too complex. If we open up idle, we have 5 different idle animations. Once again, because of how default transitions work, we transition to an empty state instead. In this case, I have named it selector because we are selecting one of these states. We transition based on an integer parameter called idle type, which will get a random value via code, and then we play a random idle animation every time. Now, because I don't want to make my code too cluttery, and I want to take advantage of what Unity offers, I have used something called a state machine behavior on the selector state. Okay, what the heck is that? Don't worry if you have not yet been aware of that, but we can add a behavior to this state. I have made a script called SSM selector by just clicking on add behavior here. We will look into state machine behaviors soon, and it is extremely powerful and easy to use. But in short, all I'm doing here is to get a count of how many animations there are and the name of the parameter. So it is going to be 5 different idle animations, and the parameter name is going to be idle type. Now there is this function called onStateEnter with a bunch of parameters that we don't need to memorize. We can simply override this function to find a random integer between 0 and count, and then set the parameter to that value. And that's it. This is so simple yet effective. And we can use this SSM selector script multiple times. Now for the confusing part, which is exiting. As I mentioned earlier, we will not be using this up state because it makes things easy. So we connect all states to exit, and we need to exit this idle when speed is greater than 0.1, which means we are not idling. This is going to be the exit condition of this substate machine. And we need to do that for all of these transitions, okay? What this means is when we exit, the control goes back up one layer to here. Now all transitions from the exit of the substate machine will be evaluated. But the thing is, these are all grayed out, which might be confusing, but it's just Unity saying, hey, one of these is not a state. Now that we have exited idle, we already know that speed is greater than 0.1, right? So we go to walk when speed is less than 0.6, and we go to run when the speed is greater than 0.6. Does that make sense? Okay, so this is very simple logic, but it could get confusing if you have no idea what this does. Okay, now that is movement done, and look how clean that looks. Now for an actual game, there may be even more states like strafe left, strafe right, turn left, turn right, peek left, peek right, and all of that. So keeping things clean and compact will be even more useful then. Now for combat. Notice how there is no transition to combat. There is only one transition when we exit combat, and that is to movement. So movement is like the central hub, and all other states like special effects or crouching, swimming would all connect to movement. Okay? And the transition here doesn't even have a condition or an exit time. It's like when we are done with combat, go back to movement. Of course, we can use layers on top of this to make things even spicier. If we go into combat, we can see another empty state, but this time the transition occurs to this empty state from any state. And this happens when a parameter called combat gets triggered. Now, usually we should add more conditions, like when we shouldn't go to combat, when we are, let's say, swimming or if we are dead, I suppose. Now, from this empty, we can transition to another substate machine called attack, another substate machine called block, and a simple state called dodge. All of these are based on simple Boolean parameters called isAttacking, isBlocking, and isDodging respectively. Inside attack, there are three different attack animations, and we use a selector state, and we reused the same state machine behavior script, but with a different count and a different parameter name called attack type instead. You can see how powerful these things are. Once we are done attacking, we no longer need to stay there, so we transition to exit on exit time set to 1. If we go up to combat, we can see that the exit of attack is connected to the exit of combat, and the transition has no conditions or exit times or anything. And it goes back to the main layer to the exit of combat, and then it goes on to movement. So I hope you get the general idea here. The same thing for blocking. We reuse our selector state again to play a random block animation, and then we exit back to movement. Okay? And there we go. We have a simple character fully animated. Cool. Now for some tips and tricks that will help you with substate machines. To begin with, you may have noticed this state called initialization. Well, what is that? This is a pre-made state that the animator will play, but it will never ever return to. Why is it here? Let's say we don't have it. So by logic, the character should go to the idle animation, right? But if we hit play, we can see a weird glitch. This is because right before we go to idle, we go through empty states, and Unity will spend one frame on each empty state, and there's nothing that we can do to change it. Remember that write defaults is turned off, and during that frame, there is nothing to play. So the solution is actually simple. We need to give it something to play at start. We need an initialization state, and it is pretty easy to make. So just select your model, go to animation window and create a new clip. I will call this initialize because I have already named one called initialization. And then we just go to one of our idle animations. I'll choose idle one and then select the first frame, Control C to copy it, and then go back to initialize and then paste it. Okay. So we have one frame of data here. It's best not to use the T pose because it may give some weird results, and we want the transition to happen from a state which is very close to idle. Okay. And then we set this as the layer default state, and then we transition to movement, and we choose the movement substate machine itself, and we transition on exit time set to normalized time 1, which means the entire duration of this clip, which is one frame in this case. Next tip is about that frame gap thing that I mentioned earlier. empty states take one frame of time. This is not going to have any effect on the naked eye, but it hits my inner ego to solve problems every time I encounter them. And the way to get over that is to use the animator.play function. Just use this function in your script and provide a state name to transition to, which could be a randomly generated one as well. And this means it will go directly to that state whenever it is called. Okay? It will directly go and play that state, and the animator continues the state machine from that state onwards just as expected. Okay? Which really means that we don't need to set all of this up. We can do things directly via code. There's no need to use the selector states. There's not even any use to using the substate machines. We can also use the animator.crossfade function for blending if we want to. We can directly do things through code. The downside of this is that we are directly doing things through code. If we are working in a team, well, the programmer would have to do all of the animation debugging, and to change the transition duration or something simple, we have to go back to code, which may cause merge conflicts when you're working with version control. Having the animator controller to be an asset is a huge advantage when it comes to working on a team or when you're using version control. Another downside is that we don't get a nice visual representation of all the transitions. There is an argument to be made that we are using more memory when we are using substate machines, especially if we are using the selector states or empty states. These are unused memory. But there is this thing in development. The more memory we use, we either save on performance. In this case, we do not focus on that. We will talk about optimizing animations in a future video. But the other thing that we can save is on development time. If you're in Animator Hell, things are going to get messed up in the long run. Yeah, this approach is cleaner, but it does require some time setting it up. This took me a few hours to properly set it up. And of course, we will make mistakes when we're doing it, okay? But debugging and messing around is way more fun this way than smashing your head against the wall. Another tip when it comes to transitions, and this is important, I find it best whenever we transition to the entry of each state and not substate machine. That means whenever we are transitioning into a state, which are things in a rectangle and have an animation clip attached to it. And whenever we transition to them, we set the transition duration to something like 0.1 if we want blending. Okay, this is the area where you focus on blending. Because there are lots of entry transitions, this may get confusing. So we need to actually transition to the rectangle and not this diamond weird hexagon shape. Okay, so we need to have a transition duration when we are transitioning to the actual state and not the state machine. But when we connect states to exit or to a selector or an empty state, which are just states without any animation, we eliminate the transition duration so that things happen fast, as there is no animation playing and we do not want to spend time waiting. In this case, attack 1 transition to exit has no transition duration. If attack 1 was instead connected to another state which contains an animation, we should use blending. Another tip is to use the up state for emergency purposes. This is completely okay to do even if I told you not to do it. Nobody is going to know. This allows you to connect to any state or state machine within this layer. You can see that we can connect to even initialization on the base layer. But I want you to limit its usage unless it is absolutely essential. That way you follow proper encapsulation and you instantly become the boss. The final tip is when you complete all of the state machine and all of these things and complete the animator of a character, export the controller and save it as a Unity package. And this way you can reuse this controller for all of your characters in all of your future projects. And the best part is that we can simply hit delete on a substate machine if we do not need it. This is the advantage of not using the upstate. If there were direct transition outside of the substate machine, then we could not simply just hit delete and make things happen. So this is the power of using the entry and exit states over the upstate. Okay. Now, Unfortunately, I haven't worked on a game in Unity for more than 3 years. And I learned all of these things during that time. So I don't have an actual example to show you guys. So sorry about that. I hope you could forgive me. And yeah, that's pretty much it what I wanted to show you for this video. I'm sorry that it took so long, but it is a confusing topic and I deliberately wanted to spend time on it. And yeah, that's it. In the next video, we'll take a look at one-dimensional blend trees. So I'll see you there. So take care. See you. Bye-bye.